Let's get into our paper review segment. The Finder newspaper reports this morning that energy debt choked economy as about some 2.5 billion annual payment for power not used ends on August 1. And Ghana-US relations to focus on strategic partnership. Nana Akufo-Addo. Government seeks to seeks approval for 6.3 billion in to top up what they had requested earlier, some 78 billion. Talk tax, energy sector levies to go up. Court throws out plaintiffs in Denchira Palace case. The Daily Guard this morning reports that Pelosi commends Ghana. 181 one district, one factory projects ongoing. An MP's clash over DC's elections. And four Kumasi kidnappers get 800,000 Ghana cedis bail. Cash for roads ready. Ken Oforiatta removes luxury tax. The Ghanaian Times says at the mid-year budget review, government halts take or pay power deals to renegotiate all contracts. And U.S. Speaker Pelosi salutes Ghana for contributing to global peace security. Minority 2019 mid-year budget is in position of hardship. Fuel prices to go up. And the top 10 most competitive fuel retail prices is in there in the Ghanaian Times. The BNFT says energy sector next after banking sector cleanup. And amid revenue shortfalls, Oforiatta asks for extra 6.3 billion luxury vehicle tax scrapped. The big one is the Daily Graphic, Ghana's oldest weekly. It says Ghana's peacekeeping role commendable. Nancy Pelosi is speaker for the United States, and government withdraws luxury vehicle tax. Anti-slavery organization lauds Ghana's fight against child trafficking, and energy sector poses challenge at state of emergency declared. Finance minister says in budget review. My guest this morning from the NDC is Mr. Felix Kwachi Ofosu. He is a deputy, a former deputy minister for communications. Felix, good morning.
Thank you very much
for your time. And Dr. Bernard Okoboah is the honorable member for the Lejokuku constituency in the Greater Accra region. Shall I add your other titles?
No. Okay, I should.
He's a board chairman.
When I was in Kenya at the point, he was a SRC vice president.
Oh, okay.
So he has always been a big man.
Yeah. So. He's also the board chairman at Kolebe.
He has always been a big man. I'm really happy to be today.
Lejokuku Jay-Z. Welcome. Welcome. How are you doing?
You're
smiling. Your road is being done and you're happy. We didn't speak for nothing.
Yeah, you know, let me start by saying a very good morning to all your viewers, and then a good one to my fellow technocrats from KNEST, my brother. Yeah, you know, I keep on saying that road is not necessarily Dr. Kobo's road. That road is the road for over 1.2 million citizens in Accra. Anyone going to Nongwa, that's Crowell, Sakumono, Bachona, Spintex, Coca-Cola, in fact, Ashaiman's, Tema, most of them use this road. And the most significant beneficiary is the hospital.
Right, the Lekma Hospital.
Exactly, where lives can be saved when you have access being very good. So, Johnny, it's not the beginning that climaxes, such a project. It is the end.
The end.
But you have to be grateful even for the start. Mm. So I'd like to take the opportunity to thank His Excellency, the President, Nana Akufo-Addo. He took a personal interest in this room. I remember one time I saw him and I was like, Your Excellency, he said, "Doc, I'll do a road for you." Because he sort of knew that any time I come close to him, I go like the road. And the roads minister, everyone who added their voice, I keep on saying that Lejokuku was like a patient who was crying that I'm in pain, help me. There were others who called the attention of the doctor, who is the government, the president. You were one of them. Other people came in and said, "Look, for the sake of this hospital, let's work on this." And now that work has started, we should all not go to sleep.
Okay.
We have to be grateful to the government, and most importantly, also monitor progress.
Okay.
So that when all is said and done, everybody can be happy.
Great. Yeah. Felix.
Johnny, well, I don't normally do this, at least on your network, but you know I have some interest in the Abrasebo Kamankese.
I know, yes.
I need to extend
warm greetings
to them.
Please do.
But there are two gentlemen I need to greet specially. Kobina Amenfi. He's one of our executives at Asebu.
Okay.
Unfortunately, he lost his mother.
Oh, sorry.
And his brother, who is popularly called Obey, they will be burying her this weekend.
Okay.
So I need to extend my deepest condolences to them.
But how's it going?
Oh, it's going quite well.
The grounds are fertile.
Absolutely. we've done substantial work over the period. So I expect that when we go into the primaries, despite the very, very healthy competition I'm facing from seven other aspirants, I would emerge victorious and champion the course of the constituency.
Yes. Absolutely. Yesterday, the finance minister was in parliament.
Before I go yesterday, you see, some few years ago, when we come in, so greetings to all those watching from the Lejokuku constituency. Those who are not eyeing the seat to say, you are always greeting your people. You see, your brother
has changed.
I've never had it. He said he's
not greeted anybody.
Well, this will be the life now.
Greeting for only the first time.
You have to get used to it. You have to greet them.
On your network. I did tell
you. For the first time, he's greeting people.
I've never had a difficulty.
Exactly.
He has to continue. He has to continue
greeting people.
Yes.
Yesterday, the Minister for Finance was Parliament. He made some propositions and is asking for some 6.3 billion more to add on to what was asked earlier in 2018. Are we on track? I must ask you, Felix.
Well, then, to begin with, the mid-year review is a requirement of our financial laws.
91.
So, absolutely. So every finance minister is required in the middle of the year to basically present an update on the performance of the economy since the presentation of the main budget the previous year. And so what the minister did yesterday was in compliance with our financial laws. But there are a number of significant developments that give cause for worry, given what the Minister of Finance presented yesterday. To begin with, I think that there was a usual effort to tout some macroeconomic indices as proof positive that the economy was on the right track. But a closer scrutiny of those indices revealed that our economy is in much deeper trouble than we are being told. To begin with, the minister admitted in his own presentation that some macroeconomic indicators are off gear. For instance, the fiscal deficits, which he projected would be around 2.9% around this time of the year, climbed up to 3.3%. What it simply means that government is spending far more than it is earning.
He justified it.
Well, it is not. You see, the point is that
there's work that's ongoing.
Well, the point is that you can find justification for every over expenditure, but it is not desirable because it throws your finances out of gear. You simply cannot spend more than you earn. So what the minister did yesterday was to disclose that he was spending more than we were earning, and it is imperiling our finances. Also, the primary balance essentially refers to government's net borrowing minus interest payments. In other words, government is allowed to borrow, but you are not allowed to borrow to pay interest on your debt. So it is supposed to be in the positive all the time. Once it is in the positive, it means that you are not borrowing to service your debt. But the minister disclosed that whereas a target of 0.1% was set, they are now doing negative 0.7. What that discloses is that they are actually borrowing money to pay interest on monies that we have already borrowed. And it's a very worrying development for any analyst of our fiscal space. In addition to this, the most worrying feature of the budget yesterday was the imposition of additional taxes. Essentially, the minister announced that ESLA, three components of ESLA, that is the energy sector and infrastructure support levy, the road fund levy, and the price stabilization levy, all of which are slabbed on fuel, have gone up by an average of 27%. So what it means is that once the necessary approvals are given by Parliament, if you go to the pump, you'll be paying a minimum or almost one Ghana cedis in ESLA levies. In the past, you would pay about 80 pesos.
If
you
bought petrol or diesel, fuel and
yes.
diesel and
yeah, if you bought petrol or diesel, you would pay an average of one Ghana cedis. Now, LPG is much more serious. The charge now is an additional 12 pesos per kilogram. What it means is that if you took a 14 kilogram cylinder to a filling depot to fill, you would pay one Ghana cedis, 70 pesos in ESLA charges.
Eight or 12?
Eight.
Yes.
8 pesos.
No, but the increase is 12 kilos. It used to be 38. Now it's about 54, I believe. So it's a 12 pesos increase. So that means that Ghanaians are going to pay more for fuel. In addition to this, the minister also announced that the communication service tax, which was passed in 2008 by President Kufuor, and had a charge of 6% slapped on every minute of call that you make, has also been increased by 50%. It means that it has moved from 6% to 9%. We are paying half in addition to what we were paying previously. What it simply means for you and I is that if you are frustrated by the increase in fuel and you want to call a station this morning and rant, you are going to have to pay more to even do that. If you want to go on Facebook or WhatsApp to rant about it, you are actually going to, President Akufo-Addo is charging you more for doing that when you are frustrated about other increases. Now, these are extremely worrying developments because already there's a whole raft of fiscal measures or taxes that President Akufo-Addo has introduced, which are breaking the back of the average Ghanaian. You recall that around the same time last year, in the mid-year budget, the minister announced a review of VAT. He hived off NHIL and Get Fund limits, and that resulted in a cumulative 5% increase in the tax. And this was passed on by, service providers and businesses. And it's resulted in a 5% increase across board on all goods and services, which imposed more hardships on the people of Ghana. Then there was the obnoxious luxury car tax.
Scrapped now?
Yes, but the damage has already been caused. What happened was that between the time that the tax was imposed and yesterday, people were paying between 1,000 and 2,000 Ghana cedis for their vehicles, which had engine capacity of above 3,000 cc, cylinder capacity. And it has wreaked havoc on many, many people who were compelled to pay the tax. It is a quintessential nuisance tax because whereas they projected to earn about 130 million Ghana cedis per annum, they were getting just around 21 million Ghana cedis per annum. So it was biting hard on the very few who were caught in the net and had to go. Despite persistent protests and demands for the tax to be scrapped, it was not scrapped until President Mahama announced that he was going to scrap it when Ghanaians voted for him in 2020. So there's been something of a knee-jerk or panic response.
The finance minister said they are listening government.
Well, they didn't listen until the former president intervened. So clearly, a political motive informs it. But the harm has already been caused, and it cannot be discounted when we come to assess the taxes that this government has imposed. There's another one. National Fiscal Stabilization Levy, which was supposed to have been scrapped in December 2017, but it was rolled over, so it has become a new tax, 5% on the profits of corporate organizations. The Special Import Levy, there's a 1% component which rakes in 15% of the revenue generated from it, and a 2% component which brings in 85%. They removed the 1% and kept the 2% when it should have elapsed in December 2017 because of the sunset clause that was inserted in the law that enabled it. So that became an additional tax, an additional burden on the people of Ghana. Even the fuel that we are complaining about, between January 2017 and yesterday, it had been increased on 23 different occasions, moving it from between 15 Ghana cedis or 16 Ghana cedis to 24 Ghana cedis a gallon. And this is going to, or this has imposed severe hardships on the people. So what happened yesterday is only going to compound the difficulties that we are having. Again, if you move from that and move and look at the national or the public debt position.
We'll come to the all public debt. So these are preliminaries.
Okay.
Okobo, why are we paying more when you promised that you were going to help us build a stronger economy for growth and prosperity? That was a theme for the budget. And we're paying more. Why?
Johnny, let me say that my brother conveniently mentioned the fiscal deficit and said that we targeted 2.9, but we've done 3.3 this year.
Right.
And it is very refreshing that you have a brother who was a part of the previous regime having issues with 3.3 fiscal deficit, because we're doing about 9.3 end of 2016. 9.3. In fact, that was on cash basis. Okay. On commitment basis, the fiscal deficit was a double digit, about 10.9. Now, we've passed the Fiscal Responsibility Act, which is to make sure that we don't go beyond 5%.
Absolutely.
Yes. Right. This is a government that decided to pass a law to restrict itself and not end up running, doing budget overrun just to get gain fever in elections and ruin everything it's done. Now, when you look at the almost all the macroeconomic indicators, most of them, it tells you that this is a country that really has recovered from a path that is very inimical to its progress to a path that is refreshing. Look at the growth. We were doing about 3.5 end of 2016. Now, as we speak, this first quarter, we are doing about 6.7. 2018, we did about 6.3. Even when you take non-oil, 2018, we targeted a growth of 5.8. Johnny, As we speak, in 2018, we went beyond the 5.8 and actually did 6.5. If you take inflation, the rate at which prices increase, the rate at which more or less your, the value of your money goes down, it was 15.4% end of 2016.
But why are the people still complaining if these figures are good?
Right. I mean, I am one of those guys who don't shut those complaining. I don't tell them to shut up. Because no matter what you how you improve, you cannot change the lives of everyone at a go. So you still have folks who genuinely have either not been directly affected or are yet to benefit from your
social
program.
But is this the workable plan?
No, no, of course it is. And you know what? I've always compared a country with improving macroeconomic indicators to a patient on the ward. If you get a very bad accident and you bleed a lot, your kidney can fail. You can be unconscious, but doctors can be happy based on the readings they are getting from you.
Okay.
If your pressure is improving, your urine output is getting better, your pulse is coming down. These are signs to tell that this is a patient who is likely to get up and will not die. So let me move from there and come to what happened yesterday. A few things. First of all, the 20% on petrol and diesel. Why would the government want to increase the taxes or put some pesos on a liter of oil? The reason is very simple. When you come into office, which my brother admits, you inherit both liabilities and assets.
Right.
And in the energy sector, the reason why power supply was not regular and reliable was because it was faced with huge liabilities. Now, they brought up the ESLA. At the time they brought ESLA, they didn't have the intention to kill Ghanaians. They wanted to solve a problem. And what did we do?
That problem was solved.
No.
The lights were kept on.
You see, it's like conflict management.
Okay.
It is never eradicated. You manage onto a place where it has come to a level where it is virtually insignificant or non-existent. ESLA, the bond we raised, using the ESLA, the bond that we raised, were able to liquidate about 60% of the debts in the energy sector.
Okay.
But guess what? At the time ESLA was introduced, it amounted to 24% of the ex-pump price. That was the inflows that were coming in. As we speak today, the inflows amounts to only 17%. Although it's the same law, the reason is very simple. It's because the nominal is the same, but what you get in terms of value is 17% of the ex.
So the ordinary Ghanaian will ask, what kind of debt are we paying?
All right.
That will never finish.
Yeah, paying. I know. I agree. I mean, tall debt is being, and we refer to them as legacy debt.
We've been paying for too long.
You know what? It's because what I see, which they also did, is that successive governments are being careful to manage it gradually and totally deal with it. You can introduce, why 20 pesos? We could have done one CD or 50 pesos so that you say within 2 years you wipe it out.
But you have done 27 increments already.
No, but 20 pesos. And remember, most of the time it's as a result of currency fluctuations and prices changes in the foreign. The factors that go into price changes are many. Some are local. If you don't manage your economy well and things are going down, it can affect the price.
Right.
But others are outside our control. And because we don't want to go into the past where you subsidize, you refuse to increase the prices, that leads to debt accumulation. But
but largely because our currency is also weak.
No, no, it's not largely. It's one of the factors.
Okay.
I admit, it's one of the factors. But if you want to attribute, it will not be the most significant.
Okay.
Yeah. And Johnny, you know what? This, the communication service tax that you talked about, this is a government that has done so many things at the same time. In fact, others say it's a miracle. We've succeeded in taking the economy from an IMF status where we're doing fiscal deficit, current account was in deficit, even trade balance was in the deficit. Now, as I speak, for the first time in 2018, we did a surplus of 899 million in terms of trade. As we speak, our deficit is under 5, fiscal deficit. As we speak, inflation is about 9.4. So the economy, that's why we've exited IMF. But the bottom line is that we've not gotten to where we want to get to. And we still are sustaining very powerful social programs. Look, for the first time...
How much more are we to pay
to get to that position of respite? The parent who has been saved over 2,000 Ghana cedis a year, who has saved that money in his or her pocket, knows that this is a government that is committed to helping all people, irrespective of social class, political party, or tribe. Number two, right, this is...
Johnny. You are rechristening me.
Your brother. Yeah, I miss your brother.
In familiarity.
Yeah, you know, see, I say it all the time because of my association with the health sector.
Right.
54,642 health workers have been employed for the past 30 months. That would be 54,000. All nurses who completed school, both public and private, from 2012 to 2016. Do you know what is refreshing? Prior to our coming, they were sitting at home. Government had not created the opportunity and generated enough to increase the wage bill and absorb them. We have done so. Teachers is about 60,000. Right. This is a government that has not made heaven of Ghana. But many Ghanaians have a personal story to share in terms of the improvements we've made. Power supply must be regular. We are committed. In fact, it's one of the reasons
We'll get to power.
Yeah.
But quickly answer this for me. So the luxury vehicle tax failed.
Yeah, yeah.
As the minister admitted, because you couldn't hit the target.
Right. You know what?
And now we're paying more to
you
talk.
See, no. You see. Right. No government is perfect. What you do is to minimize your mistakes and maximize your impact in terms of positive impact. The intention behind the luxury tax was very noble. Dr. Koboy, obviously, I'm not a rich man, but I'll be honest and tell you, I'm comfortable than others. It is a tax that tries to sift me out of the many, so I contribute quite a little more. I am content with that. We call it progressive taxes, not regressive. It happens across countries, but sometimes...
Not nuisance taxes.
No, no. I mean, the nuisance... If my brother says it's nuisance, I'll not be quick to throw it away. The nuisance happens after you've done the monitoring evaluation and realize that it didn't really achieve what you wanted. Remember, this is a government that took away about 16 nuisance taxes, from special petroleum tax to 70.5 on financial sector, to 5% on real estate, to imported medicine, 70.5. We took all this. You know why? We know nuisance taxes only for straight growth. So we will not deliberately bring a nuisance tax. But in our application of the tax, we realized that it didn't achieve its purpose. And right, this is what you do as a government if you want to stay for long. You have to listen to your people, right? And anybody who goes like, well, what about those who pay the monies? Those taxes that were brought some years ago on condom and machetes, when they redrew because it did not achieve its purpose. You can't tell them that, let's all those who used their machetes and condom come and pay back. I mean, that is extreme.
Okay.
Bottom line, right? We are committed to sustaining programs like Free SHS. We are committed to employing people into the public sector. We are committed to keeping the lights on so that the welder will not go to sleep during the day.
At what cost? That's the question.
Yes. I believe that deep down the hearts of Ghanaians, they will prefer a 20% increase on fuel to lights out and they being idle even when they want to work.
Okay. Felix.
Again, is
it so he's mentioned a lot
is it
of
funny? A lot and, of and it's imperative that I correct some of the claims here. You see, the bits about the justification for the increases in ESLA. You know, if I hear my brother correctly, he's saying that government essentially has a liquidity crunch. Of course, he didn't say it in as many words, but that is the import of his submission, because it is expanding on a broad range of social interventions. But this is at variance with what the finance minister said yesterday. The finance minister sought to create the impression that there was some difficulty in the energy sector relating to the nature of agreements that were signed, which has created excess capacity.
Which will end
and
by
therefore
first
was
August.
Imposing significant cost of government, which then meant that they had to find money to be able to meet that cost. Now, I'm inclined to go with my brother's submission, because he is at least being a bit candid that government is unable to finance its own program. But there's a point to which I would disagree with him, and I'll come to that and use figures to show.
Right.
The explanations offered by the finance minister are simply untenable.
Why?
Because why? They are in their third year. And these take or pay arrangements or excess capacity arrangements had always been there up to this point. If you recall, last year they told us that they had reduced electricity tariffs. So how is it that in the face of the existence of these take or pay arrangements and overcapacity issues, they were still able to reduce electricity tariffs and did not affect the management of the sector? The reality is that they want to get money to be able to finance some of their projects. But they are making excuses in order to create the impression in the minds of Ghanaians that it is the fault of the previous administration that they have had to do these increases. Again, now I am a bit familiar with take or pay arrangements. Whilst studying for my master's in oil and gas management, I did a lot of research in that field.
Okay.
Take or pay arrangements are nothing new in the energy sector. It is used globally. The reason why that is done is that investments in the energy sector are quite expensive. So those who invest always want to ring fence their investments and ensure that they get the appropriate returns.
Right.
Also, if you check our history as a government, we have always had issues with shortfalls in generation of electricity. All the three or four occasions that we've had to shed load on a constant basis in the 80s, in the late 90s under President Rawlings, in 2007 under President Kufuor, and under President Mahama, they all resulted from shortfalls in generation. We had just what we needed. And so whenever there was a difficulty with any of the generating units, we fell into load shedding. Now, you are going to have excess capacity. That allows you to fall on others in the event that some of the plants that you have currently go down. For instance, today, two of the plants that sustain us are Car Power and Ameri.
Right.
If for any reason these two go out, it has taken out about 600 megawatts of power. So having excess capacity allows you to fall on others. So the plants would exist, but not all of them would be supplying your national grid at the same time. But you need them nonetheless.
But where means we're paying more.
Using the excess power. The opportunity cost for not having that is that anytime you lose any of your generation units now, you'll go into load shedding. And we all know the ramifications of an extended or prolonged or protracted load shedding regime. So there's always a need for backup. It has never been an issue. Again, in any event, once the investments have been made, you are then in a stronger position to even renegotiate. So if you check the 2016 budget, between paragraphs 221 to 231, we spoke about moving to what we call a put call option arrangement, which then says that once you have established the investment in power and you have made some substantial gain over time, we are now going to go to a regime where we take only what you supply us and pay you for it. I also must hasten to add that it is not even new. The take-or-pay arrangements are not new. Look, the Bui Dam is a relief dam. It's not a dam that we use all the time. We pay with cocoa proceeds. Whether we take the power or not, we pay with the cocoa. The Asogli Phase 1, which was done under President Kufuor, was done under a take-or-pay arrangement. And it makes sense. Even the infamous toy generators that Mr. Rekubobe referred to in 2007, at the height of that load shedding exercise. Absolutely. They didn't produce a megawatt of power, yet we paid for them because of the take-or-pay arrangements. The investor needed to guarantee that he was going to make returns after the investment. So the MPP government, in its previous guise, had agreements that had take-or-pay clauses in them. And yet today, they are lamenting the same arrangement and making it seem that it is so inimical that it is a reason why they have to increase the slack. It is not true.
What has been planned for 1st August to end? How would it affect what you're explaining?
The point is that the money that they require has arisen because of gaps in their finances. That's nothing to do with the arrangements that I've spoken to you about. And my brother here has been a bit more candid than the finance minister by alluding to it. The other point is that, you see, as a matter of principle, because of their opposition to ESLA, when it was passed in July of 2015, there's no basis for them to be seeking to increase the ESLA now. You can check the parliamentary answer at the time, and he's in parliament. The likes of Professor Jamba Afuor, Dr. Akoto Osei, the minority leader at the time, all lambasted government and insisted that ESLA was not going to be supported because it was going to lead to hardships. So on what basis do they purport to increase it today? So even as a matter of principle, based on their previous positions, they are stopped from increasing ESLA beyond the hardships that they are going to impose. Now let me come to a number of issues that he raised. He spoke about the economy. You see, these macroeconomic indices that they tout, to begin with, they are not the best in our history. For the avoidance of doubt, the very best macroeconomic indices ever achieved under the Fourth Republic were under NDC governments.
They promised to achieve 7.6.
Well, I'm saying GDP that. So, listen,
overall,
no.
And he's been able to do 6.7.
If you give me time, I'll explain a few things to you. Look, the highest growth rate ever under the Fourth Republic was in 2011 under President Mills, under an NDC government. At the time, President Mahama was the head of the Economic Management Team because he was vice president.
Measured against 14.4, what targets?
No, 14.4%. It was the second highest growth in the world after Qatar, that had 17%. The year before that, 2010, we grew by 8%. In 2012, we grew by 8.8%. And of course, a number of difficulties resulted in a decline, which is not the first time in our history anyway. When you speak about IMF, they make it seem like going to the IMF was such a demonic exercise.
Was it not?
When we went to the IMF in 2014, it was the 16th time we were going. On two occasions under the MPP, under President Kufuor, we went to the IMF. This was in 2001 and 2005. Under President Kufuor, an MPP government. So going to the IMF is nothing peculiar, except that we go there to achieve support like every other country that is a member of the IMF. The other point too is that even if you check the growth rates that they tapped, it is essentially because of oil. Look, in 2016, because of the investments we made last quarter, of that year. In 2017, oil production grew by 80.6%. It led to a 47% growth in mining and quarry. That is where oil and gas is classified in the computation of our economic indices. And then that translated into a 17% increase in industrial growth. It was not due to any work that they had done. If you want to know, just disaggregate it. They are non-oil growth for 2017, around 5%, was the same as our non-oil growth for 2016. So really, nothing substantial had happened. Indeed, by 2018, it had dipped to under 6%.
Wrap up for
so
me.
Really, there's nothing much to say for these indices. They are not the best that we've achieved.
But you think that the targets that they set for themselves...
And, but the we are in the middle of the year.
Okay.
There's no guarantee that by the end of the year, they will sustain the path of growth that we are on now.
Be optimistic.
Oh, of course, of course. Oh, no, it's okay. Look, optimism is fine, but you have to be scientific and rational about these things. You cannot rely on optimism. Right. It is the scientific approach that must be used. Mm-hmm. Now, the other point about debt. I was going to talk about debt.
No,
so
he'll,
that
he'll
you come in. Debt. Because it's also an important indicator of the
performance. I wanted him because he had some objections to raise to what you said.
All right, that's
and
fine.
Then we'll talk about debt.
The other issue, fine, that's fine.
Relating to how much we are asking the 6.3 that is now being
that's
asked.
Fine,
but I'll set you off with a question quickly and then you can respond. So if Dr. Balmia says all the indicators are good, Finance Minister says we are growing as much as we want to grow, and so we are comfortable, why are we increasing stuff? Because when we were not growing, we rather subsidize stuff and reduce stuff.
That's what I'm saying, that this is a government...
It's a conundrum.
I mean, this is a government that has handled... It's been very ambidextrous. We've handled so many things, challenges at the same time, and miraculously, we still made a lot of progress. And these are scientific, like you say, the growth has improved upon the 3.5 in 2016. There's no question about that. The inflation has fallen from the double digit of 50.4 to about 9%. As we speak, deficit has come down. So all these are scientific. But you see, let me quickly say that this is a government that is running some, what's the word that Prof. Mills used? There's this unprecedented programs. Look, there is a good reason why there were folks within the NDC who said, take your time, start this program in 20 years, because it's huge. We spend an average of 1.2 billion Ghana cedis in this country to run the free agents. That is money, if we had not done this program, that is money that could have been completed maybe half of the roads that we are shouted about. But we believe in building human capital, so we will sustain it. That is why you see a government that is growing but still wants to have some influence.
The third cohorts are coming in September.
No, I know.
We have the funds?
No, why not? We are committed. That's why I said I prefer a nation where people are kept in the classroom than on the streets because we don't have money. And what people don't speak about is that there are two things happening concurrently. As we pay for the program, we're also building infrastructure. In Lejokuku, there is a building, even the headmaster has been chasing me that I should come and inspect. Every place you go around this country, we are spending an average of 1.5 billion to close infrastructure. Right, let me speak quickly about what my brother spoke concerning the take-or-pay.
I'll give you a minute so we can talk about
this. Yes, concerning take-or-pay. Look, it's very simple. Let me use an analogy. It's good to have surplus capacity. I appreciate that. What we have currently is about 5,000 megawatts. Our peak demand is about 2,700. The 2,300 is outstanding. We still pay for it, although we don't take it. Like you say, the generation capacity is there. Let's say the plant is in TV3. Even if you don't take the power from it, you pay them. And we are paying 2.5 billion Ghana cedis averagely a year for power that we don't use. That's $700.
What could we have done?
Good. Now, let me give this example. Here you are. Me. We have three vehicles in the house. The reason why my wife uses a car, I use a car. The third one is to make sure that when I have a breakdown or something happens to my car, there is another that I can use to do my rounds. So if I have three cars, when you ask me, Doc, why do you have a third one? This is the reason I'll give for the surplus.
Okay.
But imagine, if each car, it takes 1,000 on the average to repair or maintain it a year. Immediately you get 10 cars and claim that you need a surplus. In case there is a breakdown, remember you are going to spend 10,000 Ghana cedis to maintain all the 10 cars.
Is that not the same principle, your car principle? Is that the same principle Felix was
saying? No, I'm coming. But here is where the problem is.
Okay.
Getting debts, going for loans is not bad. But there is a reason why we do debt to GDP ratio. There is always a limit beyond which, when you go, it starts to suffocate you. So the point we are making is that to spend $500 million a year to pay for something that you really are not using, it is not prudent. And that is why, honestly, the judgment that went into signing those surpluses was not too good. It's good to get a surplus, but it's the extent where you need. We have our peak demand is 2,700 megawatts.
Okay.
In the next 5 to 10 years, we will not go beyond 5,000.
Right.
But currently, the agreements we signed, we have a total of more than 10,000 megawatts. Ghana, the agreements we signed, 10,000 megawatts, even in the next 25 years. Exactly. So the point we are making is that it's not devilish to have had surplus, but the extent you went.
So how much do you want to reduce it to?
No, no, no. Look, we have rearranged, we've done renegotiation for some of them. Some, we are being bold. You know, yesterday he quoted my mentor. He quoted Dr. Luther King. One of the letters he wrote from Birmingham jail. He said something. He said, when you have a person or a group of people who are willing to break a law and are ready to pay for the consequence in order to raise the conscience of society about the inappropriateness of the law, that is indeed true respect for the law. You know why he said so?
No.
We are going to cancel those debilitating, suffocating PPAs that is making us bleed heavily a year, $2.5 billion. This is more than all we spend
on the legal ramifications.
And so that's why we are saying that we are ready.
And the cost
look,
to the
look,
nation.
I don't want to mention a party's name so that it will be like I'm blaming them for what we are going through. But if you incur such a sustainable liability, I call it sustainable, it is something that will live with you every year. It must come to a point where you say, I'm not going to deal with this. And then let the one who wants to take you on be ready to face the consequences.
Okay.
Right.
No.
Right. Again.
Lastly.
Right. This tells us that when we are put in charge of a country, the kind of decisions we make can be an Achilles heel for generations to come.
Okay.
Those of us who are paying this $500 million a year, if we don't get bold and deal with it, terminate it, my brother, 15 years down the line, we'll be spending money that could have changed this country to a few companies when we are not taking
the determination
from
might cost us a lot of.
We are ready to bear the consequences because it's killing this
because
country.
Because it's not your money, it's the taxpayers' money.
$500 million a year for power you are not using.
Johnny.
That is outrageous.
Okay.
Johnny, in the, what do you call it?
Phyllis, let's talk about that.
No problem. CDD did a survey about a month ago and disclosed that between 2017 and the time that we were launching the report, we had lost 9 billion Ghana cedis to corruption. If you invest $500 million a year to guarantee yourself uninterrupted electricity supply, it is a much, much, much better investment. Look, I can assure it is just as well that the NPP will lose power in 2020.
How do you know that?
I mean the moral administration of the country is clear. The hardships they are imposing on people will get them kicked out. But if they were to remain, I can assure you that in 5-6 years to come, we will go back to doing so. Because they do not subscribe to making investments in anticipation of future expansion. It is not only surplus, what do you call it, capacity. It's not only surplus capacity that necessitates the installation of more generation capacity
expansion
than expansion.
Economy,
expansion. First of all, as I speak to you, there are about 20% of our population that do not have access to electricity.
Right.
They are touting one district, one factory, even though they have not fulfilled the promise, at least in the manner that they promised. There are more private sector players who will be setting up businesses and setting up companies. As I speak to you, there's Valco that is down, an aluminium smelter that is down because it does not have sufficient power to produce. That is an industry that can employ thousands of people and create jobs along the value chain for thousands more. So I think that we need to be a bit more visionary and expansive in the things that we
do. But the government has decided already.
It is a poor decision, I must tell you. You see, they have only used that as a justification for imposing further hardships on Ghanaians. But I told you that it has nothing to do with capacity problems. He has been candid to admit that they really need money to buy. You see, again, let's come to the issue of debt.
Right.
The minister disclosed.
200 billion?
Yeah, no, 204 billion as of June 2019. Against 120 billion as of January 2017.
122.3.
No, in fact, indeed, no. Let me explain. It is 120 billion because the fiscal year ends in December every year. They brought the calculations that amounted to 122 billion in March when we were presenting the budget, but they used the exchange rate at the time. The exchange rate at the time had significantly shifted from the December position. If you use the December figures, indeed, the Auditor General has clarified this in his report. Mm. So it is one, the Controller Accountant General too has done same. It is 120 billion as of December 2016. That's a cutoff point for this analysis. Mm. So that thing must be factored in. Now, if it has gone to 204 billion Ghana cedis by June 2019, it means that there's an addition of 84 billion Ghana cedis.
Service delivery to run plan programs.
Well, you see, again, you see, no. And you see, significantly, if you read the minister's presentation yesterday, and you look at government's fiscal tables, I have it, I can finish you with it. CapEx to GDP ratio for this year, or as of the middle of this year, is 0.7%. If you look at their projections, it should be around 1.4%. It means that very little of the monies that are coming in are going into investments that are sustainable over the years. The rest are going into consumption-related expenditure. The very thing that they condemned when they were in opposition. In fact, it is not just the addition of the 84 billion Ghana cedis that is a problem. Again, if you look at government's fiscal data, it shows that between January 2017 and the middle of this year, if you add up tax, non-tax revenue and grants, they have received something in the region of 110 billion Ghana cedis. I have not added gold, cocoa, and other export receipts that government gets. Just oil revenue, tax revenue, and non-tax revenue, 110, as at the middle of this year. In fact, by the end of this year, we project that it should go to about 140 billion Ghana cedis if the remaining component of our tax receipts should come in, and receipts from oil and other sources for the remainder of the year coming. Now, let's go to the expenditure side, because I noticed that my good friend here and some of his colleagues in the MPP like to tell that. Look, again, government's own fiscal data. When you add up the amount they've spent on free SHS, planting for foods and jobs, one district, one factory, one village, one dam, and all the slogans that they like to chant.
I have, of course,
all the capital expenditure, everything. I have major difficulty, even in the way that they've implemented it. But on another platform,
why so?
They have not been, you see, time is not on our side. The thing is that they have not fulfilled those promises in the manner that they promised. Look, for instance, and I hope that you give me time because you brought this time.
No, I'll give you 1 minute.
Just one.
Just divert to and come there.
Look, one district, one factory.
Okay.
My friend here can furnish me with how many factories they have started from scratch, even in partnership with the private sector.
Yesterday, the finance minister said they will continue to support people.
The promise was never to support. Indeed, I bring this map with me all the time. This is the map we drew. They put a billboard of this.
Exactly.
On the streets of Accra.
This Ghana, map. A Ghana map should be like that.
Well, actually, no, it's not a Ghana map. Okay, well.
No, it's a Ghana map.
That's fine. That's fine. Yes. So, one district, one factory.
Okay.
This is what they said they would do. So, to assess whether or not they have done it, you need to check what they say they have done against this map.
Okay.
What they have done is that there are about 10 factories that have come up from scratch, which is nothing new. I have consistently told you on this platform that between 2013 and 2016, in the free zones enclave alone, under the NDC, over 86 brand new major factories. Some of the factories cost $60 million to build. There's a tiles factory at Eshiem in the Western region. It cost $60 million to build. Major factory that can produce 40,000 square feet of tiles.
Let's go back now,
every day. Now, they have not done what they said they would do. They've simply gone around, shopped for existing factories, and they say they are offering them support. But that's not what they provided. That's not what they promised.
That is going to produce too.
Provided support for existing factories in Ghana. So if it was just the provision of existing factories, I don't think that Ghanaians would have voted for them.
Okay.
Ghanaians expected factories from scratch. But let me come back to the issue of revenue and expenditure. If you add up all of that, that doesn't come to above 7 billion Ghana cedis. If you add up all the expenditure in the last 3 years, everything. Meanwhile, oil receipts alone, by the middle of this year, that is from 2017 to the middle of this year, amounted to 10 billion Ghana cedis. By the end of this year, we expect that it will go to about 13 billion Ghana cedis. In fact, in 2018 alone, check government's fiscal data, there was a windfall of over 700 million Ghana cedis from oil revenue. So oil revenue should have been enough to cover all the expenditure items that I have just mentioned, the very thing that they tout as
you're saying
major
you can't find the money.
So the question then arises that what then has become of the amounts borrowed, the 84 billion that has been added, and the 110 billion that has come.
We're asking
revenue.
For 6.3 billion more.
Yes.
Is it a justified?
It is not unusual. Indeed, if you go back in our time, there were every time we went for a budget review, we demanded more money. Parliament would have to scrutinize it and approve it. So that demand really is not unusual. To the extent that the activities that that money is going to finance can be verified and can be substantiated. There's no difficulty with it. But the point I seek to make is that if you relate the amount of money that this government has received, and we estimate that as of now, if you put the borrowing together with the tax, non-tax, and oil revenue and grants, they are in excess of 210 billion Ghana cedis.
So we shouldn't be owing.
We, in our entire 8 years, and this one, I'm quoting Dr. Bamia, received 248 billion Ghana cedis. They have had 210 billion in 3 years. So what is it that they have done with that money? That makes them have the liquidity crunch that my brother is admitting to. Right. Which requires them to increase ESLA, increase fuel prices, another taxes.
Income tax. Look,
2014.
Dog, the money.
Yeah.
Where is it? Why are we borrowing more?
Right, 2014.
Johnny.
Sorry. Johnny.
It's not usual. Johnny. Sometimes when you are too familiar with somebody.
The highest growth we've experienced in recent times is true. It happened in 2011. On the back of commercial production of oil.
Of course. No
problem. Discovered under a government that focused on discovering oil. I'm talking about President Kufuor. At the time we discovered, some said it was Adremo, but that's by the way. But the biggest.
But now you're producing more.
I know. Now, the biggest surprise, well, it's not really a surprise, the saddest experience is that we dropped from 14% from 2011, within 4 or 5 years, to the lowest growth, one of the lowest, 3.5, because of course, bad economic management. Now, let me quickly say that, right? End of 2008, when the NDC government took power in 2009, the total debt stock was 9.5 billion. It increased to 122, he said 120, let me even do with this 120, 120 billion by end of 2016, before we came into office. The percentage is over 1,200%. In terms of, if you divide the 120 by the 9.5.
Now, come again, you lost me there.
From 9.5 billion, the total debt stock, by the time they were exiting in 2016, when you add all, we're doing 122.3. But I said I should keep it at 120. Let's do the 120. That's over 1,000%. When you divide by an average of 8 years, every year on the average, they were doing about 170% in terms of the debt.
What about the absolute figure?
No, let's use percentage. That's better.
No.
Of course. I'm coming. I was quiet. Right. When you look at ours, from the 120.
I hope Johnny.
Yes.
Who you are right to understand the time.
Johnny, from the 120 to the 204. The increase is about 170%. Okay. When you divide by the 2.5 years, we are doing about 68%. This is a government. You ask where the money is. Remember, even the second interchange, the disbursements, the payments are happening under our government. I say it always, that this Lekman Road that we've always pushed for, the liability on that road alone was about 25 million Ghana cedis. Incurred under a preferential, we are paying. So we are managing your liability. We are sustaining bold programs like free SHS. We are giving opportunities to Ghanaians who sat at home during your regime. 54,642
employees. You halted a lot of these projects to run an audit.
Yeah. It's unfortunate.
To say you saved us money.
But Johnny, who, which prudent manager takes over a project and immediately runs and starts running with the project? You assess, at least just to know where you are. Okay. If you speak about the length within which we did the audit, I will agree with you. Yeah. But as for the audit, it is not an option. The audit is an obligation.
Okay.
You understand? His people are listening to him. Most of the people is they are benefiting from
the people want to know where we take the borrowed money and how it benefits them.
Right, you know what? The 100,000 NAPCO graduates. I don't know. Haven't you met any NAPCO beneficiary before? If you tell them that, they don't know. You don't know where government is spending money. The point I'm making is that there are people in this country who have a personal story to share as to how this government has transformed the lives of their families.
Right.
I get nurses who come to me all the time, trained 4 or 5 years ago. They come to give me eggs in the morning.
Okay.
That we thank you for the opportunity. We are committed to making sure that opportunities are created and the lights are on. So, I don't want to come here and be
the politicians dream the taxpayers' burden.
Johnny.
Is that it?
Johnny.
It's our body, it's our collective burden.
The politicians dream the taxpayers' burden.
My dream is your dream. The employment is
Johnny,
our
a few
dream.
Basic facts. Look,
to push people into school is our dream.
One person
to pay for the lights is our dream. To get farmers to work is our dream.
You have had your time. Allow him.
But it's also our dream.
That's the point. Johnny, when President Akufo-Addo assumed office. Yeah. The lights were on. The lights were not off. President Mahama solved himself.
They were shaky.
No, no.
They were all shaky.
No, no, no. Right. But we still have power outages.
They were shaky.
We still have power outages all the time.
Oh, Johnny, they were shaky.
We still have power outages all the time.
Right.
Again, it is not correct that under the NDC we were not employing nurses. Indeed, between
there was a freeze.
No, okay, no, no, we got to go.
Really between 2000,
Dr. Bernard Okuboy, the member of parliament for the Legend Kuku constituency. Thank you. And Felix Kwachiofosu is the former deputy minister for communications. It's been an exciting time.